Hey, welcome to Puget Sound Foursquare Church. My name is John, and I'm one of the pastors here. Whether you're here from Trinity or from Puget Sound, we're so glad that you're here spending your morning with us. As we kick off today, Pastor Laura and our worship team will be leading us in a couple songs of worship, and we're jumping right in. Will you pray with me? Jesus, we are so grateful for this opportunity on this beautiful Sunday morning to come together to worship you, even online. God, I pray that you would be honored and glorified. We love you. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, worship team, we're turning it over to you for a powerful time of worship.
We'll proclaim you are here. That can bring surrender to the ground.
Wasn't that awesome? Would you go ahead and do me a favor and click that like, follow, subscribe button? Some of you are watching our service for the very first time, and we want to make sure that you're plugged in and connected with what's going on. Hey, you want to take it a step further? Share the service to your timeline for your community to see our church. You never know the lives that will be impacted by simply clicking that share button. Hey, speaking of sharing, here are a few events that are happening here within our church, and we'd love for you to come and to be a part of it. Hey, did you know that we have our own app that does all the things? You can request to join a small group or an interest group, register for an event, pre-check your kids on Sunday morning while you're on your way to church. When we're talking about tithes and offerings, you can give one time or set up a reoccurring gift, or just to see what's happening here at the church. To download the app, go to your app store on your phone, click download, and search for our church name and location. If you've already checked in once, your information should already be there. Did you know? We're always looking for more people to add to our worship and tech team. Your gift matters and makes all the difference in the growth and development of our church family. And we'd love for you to be a part of our team. Fill out an application online today. Guys, mark your calendars for Saturday, May 15th. Grab your camping chairs and join other men at the Smith's House in Lakewood at 7 p.m. Come hungry. They'll be serving up hot dogs and s'mores and spend the night sitting around the fire getting to know one another, diving deeper into community. Let us know you're coming by signing up online. Hey church, we're going to go into a time of tithes and offering. Puget Sound family, while you're on our website or on the Church Center app, don't forget to tithe there. Trinity family, you will continue to give using the same PayPal link you always have, or for now, if you want to give by check, mail it into Trinity and make it out to Trinity as well. This will change in the weeks to come, but we will keep you informed every step of the way. 2 Corinthians 9 says in verse 6, remember this, whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to bless you abundantly, so that in all things at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. We have an incredible opportunity to continue to sow a seed and watch the faithfulness of God. Whether it's there or through the mail, you can still give to the church and help us continue to be the hands and feet of Jesus for our church body, and your generosity helps us continue to do incredible things in the city of Tacoma. All right, kids, it's time for Kids Corner. I'm turning it over to our new kids pastor, Pastor Diane. Are you ready? Sending it over in 3, 2, 1.
Hi, kids. Welcome to Kids Corner. I am Pastor Diane. I hope that you got outside and enjoyed the beautiful sunshine this week. I bet you did some very fun things. By the way, did you get a chance to watch last week's video called God Sends Help? If not, no worries. Just head over to our kids page on the website to find links to the lessons. Last week's video was all about good news and next steps for the disciples. After Jesus went up into heaven, God sent the Holy Spirit to live within all of his followers. And that means that even you can be filled with the Holy Spirit. And that will give you power and courage and peace in order to tell others about Jesus. Well, this week's story is called A New Way to See. In our story today, we're going to meet a man named Saul. Saul did not believe in Jesus, but he did believe in rules. Saul loved following the rules, and he thought that the most important thing to do was to follow them perfectly. How about you? Do you like to follow the rules perfectly? I think it would be pretty hard. But something really crazy happened to change him. Are you ready to find out what it is? Well, make sure you watch the video. I think that you will be very surprised. But just a reminder, all of our kids' classes are open for both services. I would love to see you in person. Until next week, kids, take care.
All right, church, Pastor Lance is continuing with his sermon series called Endgame. If you didn't know, we've been doing a study on the book of Revelation. Just a reminder, if you want to know more about this topic, consider signing up for the Wednesday class on the same subject. We meet at Puget Sound Foursquare at 7 p.m. You can sign up online. I pray that today's word speaks comfort and reveals new knowledge and truth. You guys ready? All right, without further ado, here's Pastor Lance.
Hey, good morning, Puget Sound Foursquare. Good to see you. So glad to be together with you this morning on this beautiful day here that we get to have time with Jesus. Hey, a couple quick things as we get started. First of all, if you're with us for the first time or the first time in a long time, welcome home. It's good to have you here today. Hey, a couple of things real quickly. Those of you who are part of our Trinity congregation that are now joining us, I want you to know that on May 2nd, which is next weekend, we're going to be having a meeting following the second service. And if you can make it, that'd be great. But we're going to just be ratifying the decision that the elders have made a couple of months ago to dissolve Trinity Church and join us full-time here at Puget Sound Foursquare. There will be an online option for those of you that can't make it in. So be watching this week on the internet, and you'll find that coming to you. So, or we'll mail it to you or something. But be looking online. If you have any questions, an email info@PugetSoundFoursquare.com, and they'll give it to you. Well, Jesus, help us today as we dig into your word. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, we've been talking about the end times for the last couple of weeks. We're in week three of a four-week series on the end times in a series called The End Game, where the end game is what you use at the end of a game or some sort of a strategy that you use to close a game out. So in football, there's a two-minute offense, a four-minute offense, actually. And you can actually use that as the final play or plan to get you through to the end of a game. So that's kind of what we're going to talk about over this next few moments, about the end game and talking about that. The end game is also what we know of as eschatology, or the study of the eschaton, or the end of times, the end of days. And before we go on any further, can I just read a passage of scripture, if I could, out of 1 Corinthians? It says this in 1 Corinthians. Many of you know it because you've gone to weddings and you've read the passage before. 1 Corinthians 13:1 says this: "If I speak in tongues of all the languages of men and angels, but have not love, then I'll just be making noise and be a gong or a clanging cymbal. If I had the gift of prophecy, and if I understood all of God's secret plans and possessed all the knowledge, and if I had such faith I could move mountains, but didn't love others, then I would be nothing." Now, I read you that passage just simply because I feel like sometimes in any discussion of an end time moment, we can find ourselves forgetting love. We find ourselves getting so wrapped up into our viewpoint and why we think things are going to go down the way they're going to go down. I just want to challenge you that as we're opening the Bible and looking into some of this, there are essential truths about Christianity that never change. But then there are some truths in Christianity that God allows us some room for growth and understanding, and it can develop, and you can learn as you go, because the Bible is living, breathing, and sharper than any double-edged sword. Oftentimes, you'll be reading and studying, and as you grow in maturity, you begin to see the character of God, and you begin to see the character of why He would say something, and your viewpoint of that particular passage changes a little. I want you to know that's okay. Now again, the salvation central message of the gospel never changes, but some of that peripheral stuff, how end time stuff was all going to come about, it sometimes can develop in your heart as you look at God, right? Keep your eyes on Jesus and you'll see more about a changing movement and how God can move your heart. If you have your Bibles, open it up to Matthew chapter 24. It's a good place to start. Matthew 24, Jesus is having a discussion with his disciples here in Matthew 24. We've been talking about this. This is just a little brief review. As he's talking with his disciples, telling them about what's about to happen, keep in mind, he's talking to them at the probably Tuesday of Holy Week, when we know just a couple days later he's going to be crucified on a cross, beaten and all that. It's terrible. But this is that time, that week. Jesus had just come into the city on the Sunday to Hosanna. Blessed is he who comes in the name. Everyone loved him. And now Jesus is going to drop a big bomb on all of these ideas by saying things like this. As Jesus was leaving Matthew 24:1, the temple area, his disciples pointed out to him various temple buildings. He told them, "Do you see all these buildings? I assure you they will be so completely demolished that not one stone will be left on another." Later, Jesus sat on the slope of the Mount of Olives. His disciples came to him privately and asked, "When will all these things take place? And what will be the sign ahead of time to signal your return in the end of the world?" So keep in mind, Jesus had just gotten through saying the same thing to the religious leaders, that basically the temple or the house or the oikos in Greek is literally going to be destroyed, right? So not only are the religious leaders bummed out that Jesus is declaring such a crazy thing, but the disciples are now saying, "Hey, wait, I don't understand." And so they pull Jesus aside privately on the Mount of Olives and ask, "When will all this stuff take place? What will be the sign of your coming? And what will be the sign of the end of the age?" Now remember, they asked Jesus an intelligent question, three of them. What, when, and when? Jesus is going to give them an intelligent answer, right? So remember, Jesus will answer your prayers. He answered their prayers. Jesus didn't say, "Hey, great questions. I think I'll just throw out some big smoke screen so you'll never figure it out." Jesus was answering their question. The problem with most of us is that we don't really take time enough to unpack the setting. So Jesus is writing to a Jewish audience primarily. We're seeing through the eyes of Jewish people trying to figure this thing out. So up to this point, chapter 24, verses, I think it's 9 through 29 or 30, right in there, straight up truth. When he says there's going to be an earthquake, earthquake means earthquake. When he says coming in the clouds, Jesus is coming on clouds. When he says there's going to be wars and famines, wars and famines. There's no illusion, there's no illustration, there's no allegory here. It's all straight up prophetic truth, all right? Now, Jesus is going to turn the corner a little bit and bring them into some specificity about the heart. But before we get there, understand something. Last week, I may have dropped a little bit of touched on a nerve for some of you in dealing with the issue of the rapture. Now, keep in mind, the rapture of the church is not in debate. The rapture of the church is going to happen. Everyone agrees with that. All Christian circles agree there's going to be a rapture of the church in the end time. The question that most of us debate about, and some of us even break relationship over, is the issue of when the rapture occurs. Will it be before a coming difficult tribulation? Will it be in the middle or the three-quarters way through the tribulation or the end, a post-tribulation rapture? That's the debate, right? So I know that forever, many of you have come to me and said, "Lance, you know, how can you believe?" And you got to know this. Up to about 2 years ago, maybe even later than that, I was a hardcore pre-tribulation guy. I was studying, like I said earlier, the character of God. I'm beginning to see His love for the world and the lost, and I can't make sense of a pre-tribulation rapture. Why God would remove the church in the middle of all the craziness in order that the lost world would have to just kind of shuffle around and figure it out. Now again, I could be wrong. I want you to know that. But here's the thing. God scares me more than people scare me, right? So in other words, as a pastor, I know that one day I'm going to have to stand before God and He's going to say, "Lance, did you tell them everything I told you to tell them?" And I have to stand before Him and give an account for what I said. Now, it'd be great for me to say, "Pre-tribulation rapture, sweet, be ready any day He could come, buckle up, whatever." I could say all that kind of stuff. And again, I love that message. But there's a point at which the Lord really began to challenge me and say, "Hey, look, if it's not a pre-tribulation rapture, then Lance, you're going to be accountable to how you equip the saints moving into a post-tribulation moment." So my job as a pastor is not to feed you. My job as a pastor is to equip you. So I'm talking to you about a post-tribulation moment where Jesus could come and you have to endure an end-time moment. My prayer for you is that you learn how to endure, not study how to escape, right? And if you're right and the escape is going to happen in a pre-tribulation moment, sweet. We will hug on the way up to heaven. It'll be great. And you can tell me how right you are. But in the meantime, I want you to know my job is to equip you, right? Okay, let's go down to verse 29. Matthew 24:29. Love you. Here we go. Matthew 20 says this: "Immediately after those horrible days," say this with me, say horrible days. Horrible days. I heard you. "Immediately after these horrible days." By the way, pause. What horrible days? The horrible days, in my opinion, now looking at this, is the horrible days what Jesus was talking about. where all the craziness is going to happen immediately after the horrible days for the wars, the oppression, the tribulation. In fact, the horrible days in the Greek actually means this: the pressing in on, or the oppression, or tribulation. Right now, what's the tribulation? Quickly, the tribulation is a 7-year moment broken up into two three and a half year periods of time. So 2 3.5 periods of time equals 7 years, right? Tribulation period. That's the first 3.5 years. The Antichrist is going to show up. The temple's going to be built. Everyone's going to think he's awesome. The last 3.5 years, he's going to change his colors. His spots are going to turn to stripes or something, but he's going to be bad, 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 bad. And everyone's going to hate him because he's going to climb into the temple over in Jerusalem that's not built yet, which is getting close to be built. And he's going to climb into the temple. He's going to desecrate the temple, doing what the book of Daniel talks about, what Matthew talked about this abomination that caused desolation in the holy place. But that's going to happen, and all hell is going to show up on planet Earth like never before. All right, we're going to see that. That, it says, immediately after those days, this is some of the stuff that's going to happen, and it goes on. Now, go down to verse 9. It says, the sun will be darkened, the moon will not give light. I'm sorry, it'll actually be 29. The sun will be darkened, the moon will not give light, the stars will fall from the sky, and the powers of heaven will be shaken. Verse 30, and at last the sign of the coming of the Son of Man will appear in the heavens. There will be deep mourning among the nations of the earth. They will see the Son of Man arrive on the clouds of heaven with the power and the glory and great glory. Verse 31 says this, and he will send forth his angels with the sound of a mighty trumpet blast, and they will gather together his chosen ones from the farthest ends of the earth. That's why I get the impression over and over again, reading the book of Daniel as well, that when it says after all these things, after what? After the moon, the sky goes dark, the moon goes dark, the stars fall from the sky, all the things, the Son of Man comes with the clouds and the last trumpet blast, right? Remember, Jewish people would understand the last trumpet is the victory trumpet. There's this moment and all this stuff is going to happen. I think graves are going to open. The dead in Christ shall rise. We're all going to meet Jesus in this moment. It's going to be fantastic. But it's going to come on the heels of some dark moments. That's why I want to prepare you, all right? Now, moving into this next moment, I want you to understand something. I think Jesus so desperately wanted to prepare us that he wanted us to know things that oftentimes we have always read the book of Matthew, Daniel, Revelation, and Isaiah, oftentimes with this mindset of, I think it's so confusing, I'm just going to not touch it. I'm just going to stay with in the middle ground and just love Jesus and love his people and go to church and do nice things. And that's awesome. But guys, what would happen if you knew what was coming? What would happen if you had an eye and an ear towards the future and saw how to do that? I think Jesus now breaks into this next portion from verse 32 on into 40-something that he wants to give us 7 parables, really about 6 and then another prophetic word, but I'm going to say 7 parables that are going to help describe what I call tools to prepare us for the end times. Now, I say prepare us because I think Jesus, we can have all the information we want to get us ready for good debates. But let me tell you this, there's something about a parable that gets beneath the debate. It gets to the heart. I think Jesus really wanted to make sure that we were prepared in our heart as we move into this end time moment, right? Not just prepared for a good debate, not just prepared for be able to stand on something because you know you can hold your own, but a preparation of the heart. In other words, I think there's a moment where he says, when he talks about the talents and the 10 virgins and all that stuff, like he's trying to communicate to us a heart issue, right? So I want you to know this. Turn over to Matthew 24 and let's talk here today. He's going to mention to us a few things that are tools to prepare us for the end times. Today, I'm only going to give you 3 of them because there's no way we have enough time. And I'll give you the other 4 next week. Tools to prepare us for the end times. Now remember, in heading into this end time moment, if we are truly going to be walking into some dark, dark moments of a tribulation, your heart has to be in a good place. Because if your hand is not steady and your heart is not sure and your eyes are not aware of what's going on, you might be thrown off course. The Bible we just read said that there will be those who will turn away from the faith. There will be those who turn others away from the faith. And listen, I want your hand to be steady. I want your eyes to be true. I want your heart to be prepared for these dark times that are ahead of us, if that's the case. This is why he gave us these parables, to remind us that, listen, you can know what's coming. I remember a long time ago, my daughters and my wife, when we were all living at home together, and now they all live in their own places. Not my wife, she actually lives with me. But I bought them pepper spray and a whistle and some other stuff for their keychains. And I remember thinking to myself, I pray that you never have to use these things. And so the idea was is that they would go, you know, to the store, whatever they were going to do, but they would have these just in case something or somebody crazy came up and, you know, scared them in the parking lot or something. They would have a whistle and some pepper spray. I wanted to prepare them for the worst case scenario. It's the same here. I feel like I want to prepare you for a worst case scenario. This is what Jesus wants us to be prepared for, so we know, and we're always on the lookout for what could come about. All right, here we go. Matthew 24, verse 32. Now, Jesus doesn't even break the moment. There's not even a new sentence or chapter heading. It jumps right into this first parable. So Jesus got through saying, sun will go dark, the stars will fall from the sky, Son of Man's going to come. And then he jumps right into the next thing. He says in verse 32, it says, now learn a lesson from the fig tree. When its buds become tender and leaves begin to sprout, you will know without being told that summer is near. Just so when you see these events happening, I have described in the beginning, you can know and that his return is near and right at the door. I assure you, he says in verse 34, this generation will not pass from the scene before all these things take place. Heaven and earth will disappear, but my words will remain forever. Now remember, tool number one, here's what I wanted to tell you. Tool number one in this process is this, discernment. I think Jesus wants us to have a discerning heart as we move into an end time moment. He uses this picture here, really important. He says, I want you to understand your discernment. He says, be prepared just like the fig tree. So remember, these guys are agriculture / fishermen, Jewish mindset. They understood all that. They knew that when it wasn't even rocket science. They didn't have to be farmers. He said, hey, when you see a fig tree beginning to bud, what does that tell you? And they said, oh, it means that summer's about to happen. Right? It's no different when you're driving down, you know, up to University Place and you see that the big flower thing in the middle of the two streets as you're heading towards Chambers Bay. You know that in the springtime when you see all of those tulips show up, you're like, you know what? Easter's right around the corner. Right? You just see it happening and you know spring is on the way. You know. It's the same way here. He says, when you see the fig trees and the blooms start to shoot out, what do you know? He says, well, you know that the season is a changing. Right? So Jesus is saying, it's interesting, you got to know this. Jesus said, just so when you see the events that I described beginning to happen, I'm right at the door, right? He says, the return is very near. Now I love this because Jesus is describing, he says, what things is he talking about? He's talking about the rise of the Antichrist. He's talking about the wars and rumors of war, the earthquakes increasing in numbers. He says all of that stuff, not some of that stuff. He says, when you see all of these things beginning to happen and culminating into a moment, you will know, right? You'll know that the season of my return is at hand, right? And interestingly enough, he says this interesting phrase. He says, this generation will not pass from the scene. What generation is he talking about? Forever, I've heard people say, well, it was the generation of the disciples. Of course, Jesus was talking to them. No, he's saying the generation that is alive when all of these things start to happen at the same time, all of the things, not some of the things, because there's been wars and famines and pestilence all over the place. But he says, when you see all these things happen, including Antichrist and all the stuff beginning to happen that I just mentioned, he says, when you see that happening all together, you will be the generation and you, that generation, that one, so if we're in that generation, then we will see all of it happen. If we are not in this generation when all these things are happening, then we won't be. Now, there's a few things we know of. We know that they're really hard and heavy and hot in Jerusalem right now, getting ready to prepare for the third temple. They're literally just a handshake away from being able to get an agreement with some group of people, the Muslim group of people up there on the Temple Mount, who will give them permission to build that there. I know that they're building, they've already built the third temple synagogue. There's a bunch of buildings for the third temple already. Literally, in an amount of a week, they could actually have the third temple built. The altar has already been dedicated. There's so many things that are ready. I'm telling you, church, we might be in this end time moment. I'm telling you this with passion to tell you this. If we begin to see an Antichrist rise and we begin to see that moment happen, then we, my friends, might be in that moment. And this is exactly what Jesus is talking to. He says, listen, have discernment, right? In other words, some of us need to turn off CNN. Some of us need to turn off Fox. Some of us need to turn off MSNBC. Some of us need to just get in our Bibles and begin to read it and say, God, I need a discerning heart to see what you say about the Antichrist, not what TV says about it. Not what Google says about it. I need to see what you say about it. And you begin to dig into your Bible and see what he's saying. You have to know truth, right? And see, the problem with so many of us as Christians is we just want to push that off and say, Jesus, just bless me. Stretch out my tent pegs and give me prosperity. Well, he's saying, hey, listen, you, if you're going to be part of the generation of the end times, which I think we might be sniffing, right? I don't know, but I think we might be in the midst of that, or at least very close to it, that we might need to be ready, right? Just like if you see the fig tree start to bloom, if you see things start to happen, then you might be that time. Be ready. I love it. It says, here's how sure Jesus is. He says, heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will remain forever. In other words, guys, listen, if what I'm saying is not going to happen, then heaven and earth and the stars and skies all just should disappear. Because what I'm saying is so true that I'm dependent upon all of that stuff being true. Guys, this is for keeps. This is real. This is what is happening right now. And he wants us to be ready. Number two, second tool needed to prepare for the end times. A clear message to share. A clear message to share. He says this. However, no one knows the day or the hour when things will happen. Not even the angels in heaven or the Son of Man himself. Only the Father knows when the Son of Man will return. It will be like in the days of Noah. In those days, before the flood, people were enjoying banquets, parties, weddings, right up to the time Noah entered the boat. People didn't realize what was going to happen until the flood came and swept them all away. Swept them all away. Interesting. That is the way it will be with the coming of the Son of Man. Two men will be working in the field. One will be taken, the other left. Two women will be grinding flour. And at the mill, one will be taken and the other left. I love this. No man knows the day or the hour. Interestingly enough, it says the sun will be darkened, the moon will not give light and all that just before that. This is so important when we read this. When the Son of Man returns, it will be like in the days of Noah. Keep in mind, Jesus is telling them. Now, the days of Noah, remember that? That was a long, long time ago. It was probably crazy to the average person who knew Noah. Because at this point, when Noah got the message from God, get this, he was about 500 years old. Now I know, it's what the Bible says. It seems ridiculous. And this whole journey of building the ark it was a prophetic word that was given. I think it was 120 years. And hey, Noah, this is going to happen. You got to build this ark. And I think he took 80 years or 90 years to build the ark. In the meantime, he told people, hey, there's going to be a flood coming and all this stuff's going to happen. And I can tell you this, interestingly enough, that there's a lot of people on the planet who just looked at Noah and said, you're crazy. In fact, there might have even been people on the planet who said, listen, Noah, I love God. I think he's great. I think you're crazy, but God's good. So you keep the boat idea, the rain from sky, all that stuff. You go ahead and keep on to that, Noah. I think you're nuts, but I'm going to just do my thing. I think sometimes the church is like that when we start talking about the end times. We start thinking about this pre or post or mid-trib rapture and the end times with the Antichrist and the third temple and the seven seals and all that. And we start to say to ourselves, it's so confusing. It's so difficult. How about I just love? And we'll just stop even concerning ourselves with it. A lot of church people do that. I'm probably one of those in a lot of ways. And I can tell you this. I just feel like if we don't have a compelling message for people who could be lost and confused, and maybe even taken away. Interestingly enough, it says here, it says that there will be two men in the field. One will be swept away and one will remain. I have always been taught, in fact, I even probably taught more often than that, that the two people in the field, the one that was taken, was in a pre-tribulation rapture. But when I read this in context, this is the most important thing. When I go back and read this in context of Jesus inferring this is an end time picture, interestingly enough, here in the NLT, the New Living Translation, it says Two will be in the field. One will be swept away. That's actually a really good translation. Swept away. We have always taken it to say one will just be taken. As if, you know, they're going to be taken and their pants is going to be left down there right next to you. And you're like, hey, where'd you go? I see your pants, but I don't see you. Because you were raptured. Actually, the taken isn't a good thing. It's a bad thing. It says one will be taken, or the actual wording is swept away. Like in the days of Noah, when they were swept away in the flood. Right? Two will be grinding in the mill. One will be taken or swept away in the flood of judgment. And one will remain. Right? So that's the picture here is Jesus is saying this. If you're going to be saying this to somebody you know, then you have to have a compelling message for them. And the message has got to be more than, hey, turn or burn, sister. Brother, there's a lot of crazy in the world. Good luck. I mean, there's got to be a compelling message. Let me ask you this. What is the message in your life that's compelling enough to communicate to somebody who's lost, hurting, and broken that they want what you have? Better yet, what about someone, if there's going to be a large number of people falling away in the end, and a large number of people, and perhaps even starting now, large number of people, I got a funny feeling that those people who have fallen away, when all of the crazy starts to hit down on planet Earth, a bunch of those people are going to want to come back to a right relationship with Jesus. My question for you, my friend, is will you have a compelling message of hope and forgiveness and reconciliation that they can hang on to get them through this wiping or sweeping away moment, right? That will get them through this judgmental moment of having to deal with their own sin and what they've allowed themselves to step into. That is what I believe he's talking about here. He says that no man knows the day or the hour. What about that? Interestingly enough, I think it actually means this. In the end, the Bible says, keep in mind, think about this. Now, this is where I've always just let allegory jump in my brain and not allow true straight up prophecy. Just before this, we read that the sun's going to go dark. The moon's going to be dark. It says that there will be earthquakes in, I think it's Isaiah or Ezekiel, says there's going to be massive bombardment from asteroids or something, just shaking the earth. In fact, I think Ezekiel says it'll be knocked. The earth will be knocked off its axis. So what's going to happen to all the clocks? They're all going to be wacky. They're all going to go crazy. We're not going to know day from night or night from day. No wonder Jesus says no man knows the day or the hour, right? He wanted us to know the season, right? But I don't think anyone's going to know the day or the hour at that point. And he says, hey, listen, when I'm coming, you're going to know the season by looking at the fig tree. You're going to know the season by looking at all the craziness. Look for the season. Don't get hung up on the day or the hour. I don't think he told us to not think about the day or the hour to keep us from actually engaging in a discussion. I think he was telling us to not get hung up on the very moment, but to actually be pursuing Jesus and a clear message, right? All right, number three. Let's go on. Number three, a third tool to prepare for the end times. Number three, a watchful eye. This is in verse 42. Be prepared that you know that you don't be prepared because you don't know the day or the hour he's coming. Know this, a homeowner who knew exactly when the burglar was coming would stay alert and would not permit that house to be broken into. You must also be ready at all times, for the Son of Man will come when you least expect this. If let me just put it this way. If you were at the store and you overheard someone saying, hey, you know, there's that house over on blah, blah street, and I saw that they got a new whatever because I saw them at Costco and they picked up the whatever, and I think we should go take that thing because I've always wanted one of those things, and you're listening to them as you're overhearing them at the restaurant or the store, and they begin to describe your house's address, and they begin, and you know you just went to Costco and you bought the thing, and you're like, wait, just a sec. What? You're talking about my house? Let me tell you this. If you went home that night, chances are likely you might put your groceries away. I can't imagine that you would stay in the house and do nothing. If you knew a thief was coming that night, you probably wouldn't like put your groceries away, grab yourself some dinner, and then sit down and watch The Masked Singer, right? I got a funny feeling that you might say to yourself, like, hey, family, tonight could get weird, so we're out of here, and I'm going to call the police and have a whatever. I mean, you're going to prepare somehow, right? Listen, he's saying the same thing here. He says the homeowner wouldn't, if you knew a burglar was coming, right, you would prepare. But Jesus is telling them right here, guys, listen, be watchful. Keep your eyes open. Be looking all the time, one, on how to prepare your neighbor, how to prepare yourself, and be watching for the signs all around. Listen, as we're heading into this last time moment, in my opinion, I feel like there's more necessity of being cognizant of what's really going down in the world than I think ever before. And I think if we were to stop and realize, by the way, the world right now is almost open. And when the world starts to shake in and the fulfillment of some of these passages come true, I can tell you this, the world is going to want some answers. And here's what they're going to hope. They're going to hope that you know answers because you declared that you're a Christian. And let me tell you this, if you don't know answers, get them. Spend some time in your word. There's some places I can send you to find information. It's not all about an end time discussion. It's about a salvation message. But when it starts to get crazy, they're going to want to know what you know. My question for you is, do you know what you know? So three tools real quickly and then it'll be done. Three tools for the end time to prepare. One, discernment. Two, a clear message. Three, a watchful eye. Listen, I want to pray with you today. And maybe you have found yourself in a place listening to some of this stuff and saying to yourself, like, Lance, I don't know if I'm ready. I don't know if I'm actually prepared for an end time moment. If that's you and you're not, then I want to pray with you right now that God would prepare you by you surrendering your life to Him. So will you join me as we pray? Lord, I pray for my friends, Lord, those that don't know you and who have never surrendered their life to you. I pray today would be that moment. They would say, Jesus, I give my life completely to you. And maybe there's people here online who are watching us who gave their lives to you a long time ago, but they know they're not serious with you. And they know that you know that they know that you know. If that's you right now, I want you to just say, Jesus, you got me. You're right. This is really scary. I'm ready for you. God, prepare me for an end time message that I could have a discerning heart and a clear message to share and a watchful eye. Jesus, I need you. Lord, we love you and we pray that you draw us all close to you in Jesus' name. Listen, in Jesus' name, God bless you. Amen. I love you. Looking forward to talking with you soon. Be encouraged today.
All right, church family, before we go, I want to remind you that you can find all the information at PugetSoundFoursquare.com, on the Church Center app, or on our socials at SoundFoursquare. Church family, let's continue to be on mission together. The mission of Puget Sound Foursquare is to send loved, mended, and trained people out into our communities. We do this by showing up, syncing up, and serving. How will you do this week? Just a friendly reminder that if you're meeting with us online, that we'll be here at 10 a.m., but we are meeting in person at church at 9 and 11. Can't wait to be with everyone again next week. Be safe, take care, and we love you, church.